everyone. Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, thank you. So I have shared you the dataset and R scripts. So kindly open it in your system. We will start. So before that, I will give a brief introduction to these packages, and parallelly we will start the session. Second, I will share my screen. Yes, hope my screen is visible. Okay. So in today's session, what we are going to do is the three most popular packages we are going to use for our data science. The yesterday session completely we focus on basics and core part of R programming, and from that we have identified R language is majorly based on the packages and its corresponding functions. In that, the three main packages which is more related to data science and popular for analytics in R is the major packages are DPLOR or DPLOR. So however you want, you can pronounce. There is no proper acronym for this DPLOR. And the next one is ggplot, and the next one is caret. Okay, so caret is nothing but classification and regression trees. So ggplot is for visualization. It's somewhat equivalent to matplotlib in Python. Okay, first we will go with the DPLOR package. So in yesterday's class, we have discussed about the basic data manipulation in the data frames. Here, the data frame only in this entire session, we will speak about only data frame, because so in this session we will speak mostly about the data frame. Why we are speaking data frame? It's because the data science, we are going to do some manipulation, or we are going to extract some useful information from the data set. In most of the cases, data set will be in the form of a matrix form, that is in this R specific data structure, it is in the form of data frame, which is like a two-dimensional matrix where row indicates samples, column indicates the corresponding attributes. Okay, so if you take any data set, each row will be a sample and each column will be a corresponding attributes related to the data set. If you want to consider a student data set, each students will be in a separate row and the attributes related to the students will be in the columns. If you take a sensor data set, for time period T1 to TN, all the T1 to TN will be a row and the corresponding devices. If you are taking from a multiple sensor, and the sensor values will be in the each column. At last, one column will be called as class variable. That class variable is nothing but we are going to perform some operation based on that class variable. So I hope everyone have a brief introduction about the classification, regression and clustering. So based on this, so I am not going to cover that part here, and majorly we will speak about how R will perform those kind of classification. So before directly jumping into the classification, we need to know the basic manipulation of data frames. So how we can manipulate the data frame? Yesterday itself we have saw some of the core part, but today we are going to discuss somewhat highly optimized function for manipulating the data. So as I have mentioned, we have already discussed about the subset part and dollar operators. So it is for taking the values from the data frames in terms of rows and columns. Whereas dplyr package provides a highly optimized set of routines for dealing with the data frames. So for the history of if you see the history of dplyr package, it was developed by Hadley Wickham of RStudio. And the point I want to highlight here is the dplyr package does not provide any new functionality to R. Okay, so you have a R base package, the R distribution by default. When you have installed R on your system, by default the base package was installed. By using the base package itself, you can manipulate the data frame. This dplyr package was developed and you have to install manually, where it does not provide any new functionalities. But what it will provide is, it would simplify your code and it will optimize your code. Okay, so when we are writing a complex code for manipulating the data, in dplyr package, we are doing it in a simpler manner. So it is like providing a grammar for the data manipulation. And the dplyr functions are comparatively faster than the core base R package. So some of the basic grammar in dplyr package are select function, which is used to return a subset of columns of a data frame. Okay, so select is, we are returning a subset of column, only it will speak about columns of data frame. For filter, it is used to extract a subset of rows. Okay, select is for columns, filter is for rows, whereas arrange is to reorder the rows of data frame. And renaming is, we will think rename what is in that, but renaming in a normal base package, it is actually very difficult, whereas they have a separate function rename to make the process easier. And the last one is a pipe operator. So pipe operator is used to connect multiple commands together and form a pipeline. So one function's output will be given to another one, and this function output will be given to another one. Like that we can write. Okay. In all these functions, select, arrange, rename, so all these functions have common characteristics. What are the common characteristics is, the first argument is a data frame, and the subsequent argument describe what to do with the data frame specified in the first argument. And you can refer columns in the data frame directly. Okay, this is the main point. Here we are not going to use the dollar symbol for accessing the column. In our previous case, in the last session, we have used a dollar, right? This dplyr package where we are not using dollar. And the return result of a function itself is a new data frame. If you want to store, then the stored object will be of the class of data frame. And data frame must be properly formatted and annotated. There should be one observation per row and each column represent a feature. So this I have already told, data frame is nothing but a properly formatted. You can compare it with the Excel sheet, spreadsheet. Okay. So everyone, this actually you got the updated session, right? So we have only one session now. So we will parallelly do the hands-on and directly we will start executing the code. So 11 o'clock itself, we have to complete this entire three packages. So we will start with that. To install and loading the dplyr package, what we have to do is, first thing you have to install, then you have to load the library into your R session. When you are installing and loading, you will get some warning. Why? Because dplyr package, as I have already told you, this is not new function. It is modifying the, it is actually a way to improve your coding part. So what it will do, it will mask the masking in the sense suppressing the existing function, and it will sit on top of that and it will execute. Okay, so you cannot access the lower level function, base function. Okay, that's why you will get some warning when the package is loaded that have same name as functions in other packages. Okay, so let's move on to this RStudio. I will open it. So first, as I have already installed, even though it will, I will install you. So first I am, you just uncomment this part, because after this execution, you just please comment that. Okay, because every time then it will run and it will create some problem. So I am running this code. I am selecting these two, just I am installing the packages. So here it is asking some warning. So restart R prior to installing. I am giving yes. So my session was restarted and unable to establish connection with R session. Okay, something. Close everything. Yes, I think now it's installing. Some warning it is giving, actually. That is no problem. First one is, I don't have R tools with me now. So it's not a big issue. You see that screen, it is downloading the package. Okay. And I'm installing another package, that is mode estimation. Whether everyone can see my screen, whether anyone is having issue with that, please drop a message in the chat box if you can't able to see my screen. Okay, no, not visible. Okay, one second, I will stop sharing and I will start again. Whether it is visible now, please drop a message. Yes, visible. Ah, okay. Okay, what I have done is I will repeat again. Here I have commented this part with hash symbol. I removed this two comments, and I have executed this code. So if you do this one, it will download and it will install the package. Okay. If I do now, I think I will do it again. You see, like this screen will come. Yes. Okay. So mine is downloaded and installed successfully. And now we are going to attach our package to the current R session. For that, what you have to do, you have to load the libraries that we have installed, the packages we have currently downloaded, right? We have to attach it to our R session. For that, the code is library of the package name. So I am running this. So this is where the warning I am telling. So when you are attaching, it will show the following objects are masked. The following objects are masked from stats pack, base pack, and this is version. This is not a big issue. So these two only I have told. So these are the functions which was already available that we cannot use now, because this dplyr package have the same name as this name. Because of that, it overrides this function. So you know function overriding, right? Similar to that, it overrides this function. And if you are typing filter function, it will execute filter function from dplyr package. Now we will load our data set. I have shared a data set with you. I hope everyone got the data set. That is, the data set name is chicago.rds. So for RDS, what command I am using is read RDS. So read RDS, nothing, only one parameter, the RDS file location. So here it is my location. You please be careful with the slash. As I have told yesterday, this is the most common mistake we will do. Now I am running this part. Okay, after execution, I got a new data here, Chicago, which is of 6940 observation. Observation in the sense, here it is rows. Okay, so 6940 rows of 8 variables. 8 variables in the sense, it's a column. If you want to see from the code part, you can use dim command, which will give you the dimension of the current data set. And if you want to see the complete structure of the data set, you have to use the str function. You can see the data type. This is the major thing we will get. What we will face error is, because of data type we will get error. Because of NA data, that is not available data, we will get some error. Okay, here character, number, date, number. Okay, so these are the different data types we are using, and our data have NA. You see, there are lots of NA available in our data set. This data set is nothing but air pollution data set of a Chicago city. Okay, this data set is nothing but air pollution data. So here city, completely it will be Chicago only. This is temperature. This is a dew point temperature and date. This is PM 2.5, actually, that size of the particle, that is 10, then O3 mean, then NO2 mean. So these are the data set they have given. And I want to see the first 6 rows of the data set. Okay, so I am running this. I am able to see first 6 rows with all the 8 columns. Now yesterday I think one of the participants asked about finding the mode of a value. Okay, so there is a no it is not there is no built-in function. It is available, but in base package there is no built-in function for mode. But for that only I have installed another package called mode estimation. That is a separate package where we have a function called MLV. So to identify the mode, I am creating a new object called stat mode. I am using a function named MLV. What variable I am going to pass is Chicago dollar. That is the column name of PM25 T mean 2. So this variable is right. This one. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Fifth column I am going to pass as an input. And method equal to MFW. So these are all, actually this function was developed by a third party and we are utilizing. That is, by default you won't use the mode function. But mean everything we can use by default. And if I don't have this, okay, my mean to have some not available data, right? If I don't have any, commenting this, I am removing this part. Now I am executing this two line. Okay. For me, I will get error. Argument X contains missing values. So missing values are not handled here. So now I will comment this line and I will execute this part. Now I am handling NA. Now my stat mode got executed and the mean value for that is 11 point, sorry, not mean, the mode value is 11.3. Okay, so this is how we can calculate a mode for the particular column or particular R object. So next we will go to the deep layer package. First function is select function. We'll parallelly share the so we have installed a deep layer package. First one is select function. Here select function can be used to select columns of data frame. Often you will have a large data frame which have too much of data, but your most of the analysis will be based on either some part of the column, some subset of the column. So you want to do subset for both rows as well as column, but column subsetting is more important than row subsetting. The select function allow you to get these few columns you might need for the data analysis. Normally, what problem we will face without using deep layer package is the colon function we will use in the base package cannot be used with the names or string in the base package, whereas it is possible in the select function where you can specify a range for a variable name also. For string also you can use the colon, and you can also omit variable using the negative sign. So additional, before going into the additional option, first we will see how select will work. So if there is no deep layer package, I will show how what error will happen. I have loaded the Chicago packet data and I want to take the first 5 rows and I want to print the column, right, city to DPTP. That is first 3 column I want to print. What it will happen is, here one error was there. I have typed a hyphen. You change it to hash. Okay. if I run this, so object city not found. Okay. From this head packet, we want to print only these three column and first five rows, but it is not taking because the colon operator, it is not working for name. Now what I am doing, that is the another way of doing is, I am making it as comment. So names of Chicago, I am running, I am getting all the names, right? So now I am using select function with the city to DP TP. Okay, it is more simpler way of getting the data. If you see that, I am storing in a subset. Now I got the result. First, five rows. Instead of that, I have copied the entire Chicago data set. If I want, I will take first point. Okay, we will come with this later. And now we are going to use the negative sign to remove the first three columns. So how I am going to do is, without select function, what is the way I have to do is, this is the way I can do the first three function I can remove. Like I want to use the match function. I want to check whether a column name city is available in my data set, and for that the input is names of Chicago. Okay, so the names of Chicago will give me the all the column names. In that I will match any city is there. If it is there, I will keep it in a object called I. Okay, if you see the values I, it have a integer 1L, that is first column, and in J I am matching DPTP, and the name is, I am Chicago, I am searching, and it is giving 3L. This is 3, third column. This is first column, this is third column. City is first column, DPTP is third column. And if I want to negate, using negate, first remove the first three function, I have to do like this. The entire rows, that is blank space, that means all the rows, and I am negating I colon J. So 1:3. It is like taking the value, converting into an integer and passing the range using the colon. But if I am executing this, you see the result. Okay, this is the result I got. Wait, I will use Control L. Then only you can easily match. So now you got this result. You have removed the first three columns. And if I want to do the same using select, it is very much easy, where within a single line I will do this. Whereas it required this much complex task. I want to convert the name into an integer and I have to pass this integer as an argument. Whereas I am just giving a select function, what is my data, negating city to DPDP. That's all. If I do that, I will get the same result. Okay. If you see, we are getting the same result. So in select, there are multiple options available to remove the columns. So we will see what are the different options. First we will see in the slide. So we have multiple options. The four main options are starts with. If you want to select a columns that start with four main options columns that start with, you can use a start with function. Similarly, if you want to check with the n character, you can use ends with. And similarly, we have a contain function which contains a particular string in the column name. Based on that, it will select. And at least any one of the thing was available, then it will give us the result. So we will see example for each of the option. So, first one, we are using the start with function. I have a select option, and in that I am passing Chicago, that is the original data set. The one more point I forgot to tell is, whenever you are using this function, if you are not storing, it won't give you, it won't have a separate R object, won't create. Okay, and don't use again Chicago here, then your entire data set will become a subset. Your all the data will be removed. I have told you, right? R won't give you any warning if you are overwriting any value. If I have written Chicago here, my entire data set will change. That's why I am using a variable name called subset. That is given by you only. You can use any name. We will come to that select option. I am passing this input data, and I am giving starts with D. So what are all the functions which starts with, what are the column name which starts with D? I want to see that. So I am running this code, and I have two column name which have starts with D, DPDP and date. Okay. And next one, I want to check what are the data set ends with 2. I have four data columns which is ending with 2. That is PM25 mean, that is PM25 mean 2, O3D mean 2, not number 2 mean 2, sorry, NO2 mean 2. And the next one is, I will check whether that column name contains the word PM. And I am using that. There are two columns, PM25, PM10. Okay, so now we have completed the select option, and we will move on to the next option, next function, that is filter. This one actually, I want to check how many, we have seen the mean value, right? That is, sorry, not mean value, mode 11.3 as a result we got. How many 11.3 was there, I thought to see. For that I have created this one. So there are 17 observation which is having 11.3. So mode is nothing but the column, the value which is more frequent, that is considered as a mode, right? So here 17 times the 11.3 is available in the data. That is the result we got. Because before going into the filter, we have to know what filter is used for. So previously we have checked with columns. Now we are moving to the rows. There are 6940 rows are there. I want to see only the rows which is having the value 11.3. That is mode value. For that, I am using filter function. Select function is for columns. Filter function is for row. I'll go to the slide. Yes, the filter function is used to extract subset of rows from a data frame. We'll see the simple example here. So I am filtering the row now, and I am giving a condition here. I want to see all the observation which is having particle 2.5 mean value which is greater than 30. If I am running this code, now you see there are 194 observation here. Out of 6940 observation, there are 194 observation we have which the PM value 2.5 is greater than 30. If I do the summary, this summary function, what it is giving is, what is the minimum value in my data set, in this 194 data set, which is greater than 30, my minimum value is 30.05. And the first quartile, value is 32.12, median 35.04, mean 36.63, third quartile 39.53, and maximum value is 61.50. Here, if you see, the first quartile, minimum is the lowest value. First quartile is taking 25% of your data, and what is the mean value? This median is the 50%. Then this median is the center value, mean is the 50%, and third quartile is the 75%, max is the highest value. Okay, so it's about the whole summary of your data. I think Chicago data set did not work. Whether any other having issue with the Chicago data set? It's a very basic data set, sir. I think it will work. I don't know. Maybe with in your system, it may be a problem. Whatever data set you can use, that is not a big issue. Even R have a multiple data set available inside. So from next experiment and all, we are using our own data set. I think only that sir have issue. Okay, we will continue with that. If you want, you can use some other data set also. This R code, just you can uncomment and you can run, it will work properly. Similar to that only I have written this everything and I am sharing here. Okay, so we will come to this filter option. After this summary part, and I am here, I am giving a logical condition here with addition to this PM value 30, and I am also comparing with an AND operator which is having a temperature greater than 80. So after running this code, if you see my column value, after 194 observation, it comes down to 17 observation. I am be more specific in choosing my row values where these two condition has to satisfy. If you see the temperature here, all the temperature values are above 80. If you see this here, it is temperature 23, 28, 25, 57, everything is here. But I am more specific and I have given combining two conditions here. And the next one is arrange function. Arrange function is nothing but ordering the data. Any information I have kept in the slide, I will see. Yes. Arrange is to reorder the rows of a data frame according to one of the variable. When we think about without deep layer, this reordering of data is also a painful task. With the arrange function, where it simplifies the process quite a bit. And we have an operator called DESC, where it is used to sort the order in a descending order. Sort the column by descending order. Now we will see the data, and I want to show you how much difficult to reorder without arrange function. Okay. If you think that this is the first, I will comment this one. I will execute the second part. Here we have a data type called date, right? So we have a separate column called date. You see here. And what I am going to do is, I am going to order my data set based on the date. I am going to order by date. What I have to do, I want to, after ordering, it has to reflect in my data set, right? So first thing, I am doing this as a Chicago of, in that I am going to order based on date. If it is not date, it has to convert into the date format. So as dot date, Chicago dollar date, because we are not using dplyr function, that's why I am using dollar function. Chicago dollar date, if the format, if the data is not formatted, we have to give a specific format, percentage y, percentage m, percentage d, year, month, date format. So in this format only it is available. Okay, so similar to that, we have to give and we have to consider all the remaining part. So for that I am giving blank space. If I do that, I am running this code and I will see the first six columns. If you see, all the date was order based on the year, starting with 1/1/1987, 2/1/3/1/4/1/5/1. So it was ordered based on this date format. But the thing is, like, in our data set, if you see the structure, the date, we can see it from here. The date was already in the date format. Okay, so this much complexity is not required. But if your data set have a date and it is not particularly in the date type, then you have to order using this much big code. Okay, but if it is in data type, even though the code is somewhat difficult, where you have to code like this. I am running this, I am getting the same output. What I have removed is, like, I am removing this format part, because this formatting was already done by the data set itself. And the next one, using arrange function, how simple it is. This is the code, that's all. Arrange Chicago by date, and I am storing it in a variable, object. I am executing this, I am printing this, that's all. You are getting the same result. Okay, it's very much simple. It will simplify the task. We will think whether it is that much complex, but see the code, how much complex it is, how much simple it is. And I want to show you the descending order using this. So from 1987 we started, right? This is the last date. So our data set, we come to know that it is between 1987 to 2005. 31, 12, 30, 12, 29, 12, 28, 12. So descending order I have sorted. So this is the advantage of a dplyr package, where you can easily code and for manipulating the data. So now arrange function we have completed. So this is the part I have showed you. Now renaming. Yes, renaming, we will think it is a very simple task, right? Renaming a variable in a data frame is surprisingly hard, actually. The rename function, which is designed to make this process easier. The syntax inside the rename function is to have the new name on the left side of equal to sign and old name on the right side. That is new name equal to, for old name, it will be replaced by the new name. There is another that is having some issue. I will function itself, we can rename the columns. In that I will tell you. Okay, so renaming part, I will first show you this code. Why I have written you is, up to now we have used head for printing the first six rows, right? Right. Now you see here, I am forcing this, you see here, three is an optional argument. Optional argument. If you remove that, it will print first five columns and six rows. But here I am forcing the first three rows. Okay, first five columns and first three rows. If I remove the three, if I run, it will show me the six. Okay, difference you have to know, that you can force the head to see only one or three or six. By default value it is six. Okay, and now we will come to the renaming part. Normally this one, how I have to rename is, I am using the rename function. Obviously, the first argument is your data set. Now, I want to give new name to the DPTP. So, instead of DPTP, I am giving dew point. Dew point equal to DPTP. PM25 equal to PM25T mean 2. Okay. So, like that, I have renamed. And I will show you the first three column again. Now I think here command is not visible. I will clear the screen. First I will run without renaming. Next I will do the renaming and I will run. Okay. Now you can see this DPTP here, it is changed to dew point, and this PM25 mean 2 is changed to PM25. So this, why this rename function is required, because you are collecting, you are using the data set from different sources. You are not creating your data set. Maybe the person who is creating the data set will have a different naming convention. He may give a very complex name or a very big name to provide you much information. But after knowing that your data, you want to cut short it and you want to give a concise name for that. Then that time the rename function will help you, because everything, every most of the time when you are speaking about the column, we will go by name only. Most of the time we are not using the dollar symbol and we will take the value, because dplyr package you can directly pass the name. So for that we need a concise name. For that we need a rename function. Okay, this is how it came. And another way of renaming inside the select function. Select is also a dplyr function where we can do the renaming part. I will show you. Okay, I will run this code. Now you see the difference between the actual rename and the select rename. In this select rename, I am taking first argument is Chicago, and dew point equal to DPTP and PM25 equal to the same similar I have passed. It won't show me an error. But the thing is, like, all other remaining columns will be removed, and only you have to the only thing is the columns you have changed name, right? That only will come, and other remaining columns will be omitted. That is the problem with the select. If you want to do all the columns, renaming all the columns, then you can use the select function for renaming and you can pass, or else rename is the best way to rename the columns using dplyr package. And I have given you an exercise here, like rename a column without using dplyr package. So after this session ends, you can go through and you can check how we can rename if you are not using a dplyr package. Okay, how much complexity, you go and see. So this is the output screenshot I have shared, and the pipe operator. So pipe operator is very handy for clubbing multiple or commands together. So when you are doing a sequence of operation, you think that this part you read, if you have three functions and you are executing a call inside. So we are just passing the input of first function to the second function and passing the input of second function to the third function. So our code will look like this. Okay. Maybe because of this words, it is showing smaller one. You think in the perspective of function name, for each function you will provide argument first of x. Here along with x you will provide many arguments. Here along with the second you will provide many arguments. Here for along with that you will provide many arguments. So each function have different arguments. Your function call will look like a clumsy, okay, nested function calls. But this pipe operator will allow you to pass the output of one command to the another command. So here if you see, the order is like this. I want to pass x as an input to first. Based on this output I will pass to the second. Based on this output, I will pass to the third. Similarly, it will work. Okay, so I will go with that. So for pipelining, I am using a built-in data set available in the car, R, that is called empty cars data set. Okay, this was already available in R itself. If you do directly str of empty cars, you will get a structure. You have not created anything. If you see your data, you won't have anything, but it will work because it was already preloaded by your R itself. So after I am seeing this structure, what I am giving my code is, so first function is my data set itself. Here I am passing the entire data sets as an input to a filter function. So what filter function will do? It will extract the rows based on the condition. Here there is a condition called, here there is a variable called carb, that is an attribute name. This is car data set. Okay, car data set in the sense different cars with their properties along with the mileage information is available in this data set. In this car, there is a component called attribute called carburetor. So car, this have a carburetor, right? This carburetor, if it is greater than 1, this will give me a subset of a empty cars. Okay, filter will give me a subset of a empty cars that I am passing input. Okay, again I am passing this input to a group by function. So group by is nothing but, here we have a variable called, attribute called cylinder, which is having different values. Your car have a cylinder, 4 cylinder, 2 cylinder, 2 cylinder engine, 4 cylinder engine, 6 cylinder engine. Similar to that, we have a option called cylinder, and I am grouping the column by this cylinder value. And at last, I want to summarize the mileage which is related to the this cylinder. I am grouping by cylinder, and based on that I want to check how much cylinder is related to mileage. So first I am based on carburetor, I am getting a subset of data, and I am grouping by different cylinder values, and I want to create a relationship between the cylinder and the mileage. So normally we will tell, right, cylinder is nothing but you can assume like a CC. If a higher CC will, it is not all the case. Mechanical engineering and automobile engineering might know very well. So if you are going for a higher CC, your mileage may drop. So similar to that, you can think of. It's not true all the case. For example, I am telling you. So here I want to match the relationship between cylinder and the mileage. And after that, I am summarizing it as a result, and I will give you. To execute this part, if you keep that part, if you keep that running this code, you are getting a result, right? There are 3 cylinders available in our entire data set. If you see the structure of the data set, that is total of 32 observation, 11 variables. In this 32 observation, there are 3 different cylinder values available, 4, 6, 8. For 4, the average mileage is 25. For 6, average mileage is 19.7. For 8, average mileage is 15.1. So from that, we can infer that if you increase the cylinder value, the mileage will decrease. That is, when you are increasing the CC, your mileage will get decrease. Like that, we can infer the data using this pipelining concept. So to show you that only 4, 6 and 8, 8 is available, I am giving a factor variable, that is empty cars dollar cylinder. This is the variable, this is the actual data. So if I am using factor, what will happen? How many values are available? It will tell me 4, 6 and 8. So to show you that, I am using this code factor. Okay, it's just for a validation. So these are all the major functions, basic functions available in the dplyr package. Okay. So now we move on to caret. At last we will come for ggplot. As per PPT, I have kept a ggplot second. First we will move on to caret, and at last we will come for ggplot. Okay. So caret is nothing but a short for classification and regression training. The first question we will get is why we need a caret package. What is the major advantage of caret packages? We have a multiple implementation of machine learning algorithms in different R packages. There are different R packages available which have a specific implementation of different machine learning algorithms. If you see, nearly 100 plus machine learning algorithm available, but it is challenging for the user to know the all the package names and to know all the tasks. What caret will do is it will help you to call the function and execute for your code. Caret is nothing but it is a group of multiple machine learning algorithms which was available in the different packages. For you, what it will ask is, it will just ask you to download it. It will search for you. If you are running, if you want to implement KNN algorithm and you don't know how where the KNN actually it is, what package we have to use, you don't know. You just install caret. You call KNN. This caret will download KNN for you. It will provide you the function. You just pass input. It will show you the result. That's all. So it will make your process more easy for applying the machine learning. That's what I have here, like written here. No matter which package the algorithm resides, the caret will remember that for you. There are different pre-processing functions in caret. Before that, we will first start with the caret. Yes, this caret, actually, if you are installing this code, have different packages. If you see that line, it will take multiple packages. There are a concept called dependencies, everything. So now, instead of installing packages using command, I am installing via this GUI. I am going to packages here and I am clicking the install button, and it will show me this window. I am writing caret. So it will give me the name. Here there is an option called install dependencies. What are all the one package when we are writing, we may not write completely from scratch. We can use some other packages for our operation. For example, in my R package for random projection, I have an inbuilt functionality to classify. So for classification, I have added this as a dependency, the caret package as a dependency. And whenever you are installing random projection, if you have enabled this option, dependencies, this caret will also install along with the RandPro package. Okay. Because it will, my package is dependent on this package. But one advice is, whenever you are writing code, try to minimize the dependencies as much as possible. Because you consider caret is very popular package, no problem. This package won't go out of CRAN often. But there are some small packages available in R, where if you are depending on that package for your code, due to some maintenance or some other part, if the user is not maintaining the package properly and the package was removed, and then what happened to your code is your code also will give you an error. So the major task when you are developing an R package is to minimize the dependency part. Then only your code will execute in a longer run without any issue. Why I have installed, why I have in my package caret I have depended is like the caret is very most commonly used function. That won't go out of the R easily. But when you are taking of a small packages, you think along and decide whether you want to depend on that package for that particular function. If it is possible, you try to recreate the same code and don't use the dependency that much. Okay, so I am installing dependency. I will click install. So now this R itself is giving me install.packages caret. So for me it is downloading. If you install, for you also it will take some time to download. And package caret successfully unpacked and MD5 sum checked. After this, if you have installed, it will come here. You see, there is a caret package available here. We are using another function called library of caret, right? This library of caret. If you don't want to use that code, there is also option. You just click this tick mark. Automatically, this code will get executed. Okay. Easy, right? If you click the tick mark, it will automatically attach to our R environment. So now we will try to import dataset using weblink. Actually, currently my network is having some firewall issue. If anyone they are using mobile data and connecting to your own network, you just delete this comment part and you just comment this one and you execute this. This HTTPS colon, I will check now whether it is working or not. Last half an hour before I have checked, it was not working. First I will remove all this. Yes, I think now it is working. Yes, fine. I'm removing all this part to make it clear. Yes. Up to now we have downloaded our data set and we are using, right? We have not anything used directly from the internet source. So this code will help you to understand how to directly download. The same function I am using, read.csv. In the path name, instead of my local path, I am giving the path of the CSV file available in the web server. So this path I am giving, from that it is taking my data. So I have cleared everything. I will run once again. Yes, my orange data is loaded. It is having 1070 observation, 1070 rows and 18 columns. Okay. If you have issue with this command, you can download and you can execute from this command. That is up to you. Okay. If anyone have executed this command, just post it in the chat box. I will check once whether you got. Can you suggest name of dataset in R? Yes, this itself, last we have saw, right? That empty cars. Similarly, iris data is one of the popular data. You can work it on. Sorry? Please type your comment, any comments in the chat box. I think some problem with audio. I'm not able to hear properly from your side. I think someone is speaking, right? Okay. Okay, I hope this link is working for you as well. And I will move on to our next one. Then only we can complete on time. I thought of last 10 to 15 minutes telling about some research based R. Yes, I got from working. Yes, one comment. Okay. Thank you. So this is just to see the data available in this orange packet, that is structure and header. Before directly jumping into our machine learning model, we need to do the data preparation and pre-processing. I hope you all know this step, right? For that, first I want to convert my data set into two parts, that is training data and test data. First thing, I am using a function called set.seed of 100. This set.seed function is nothing but when you are using a sample function in your data, because when you are speaking about taking the training data and test data, it is like a sampling, right? You are from the entire data, you are sampling and you are creating a two new data. There is a possibility of getting different outputs for the same type. That is the advantage of sampling here. But the thing is, like, when you want to check whether your code is working properly, it is difficult to backtrack, because if you run again, your code will change. You can't able to compare the accuracy. First time I am getting accuracy of 90 and I am changing some parameter and I am running again. Now it will come up with a different data set and my accuracy will change. But I want to change the impact of parameter with the same data. So for that only we need a function called seed function, where it will give you the same output unless and otherwise if you are changing. So this seed is nothing but for creating the sampling data. Okay, so for sampling the data won't change. And the next one, we are going to partition our data. For that I am using a function called create data partition, which is from caret package, and for that I am giving a input, that is I want to check the number of rows. For the sake of easiness, I am giving the first column name orange dollar purchase. Even if you give the second column name also, it will give you the same result. Okay, first I will go with the purchase itself and I will run for you. Yes, if you see here, there is a training number of row, one integer variable created with 1 to 857. So this 857, how we got? We have 1070 observation. From that we are dividing. One second. So I got a comment, my console screen is not working, what to do? It is, maybe you have minimized it, sir. I think it is not working. It console is nothing but maybe you have minimized it. Your console will be here. If you have any issue, you just close and open your R, or you can just view. Here there is a pane option will be there. You check whether the console option is enabled, or else you click this show all panes. Maybe you have forgotten, you have come out of the console pane. Okay, so I will move to the next part. Yes, how we got 857 is, we have 1070 observation. In that we are taking a probability, p is nothing but a probability. We are giving a 80% of our data we are converting into training data, remaining 20% of data will be considered as a test data. And for this 80%, if you calculate 1070 into 0.8, you will get 857. So this 857 variable, 857 number is important. So we need a 857 number. Even if I remove purchase, I am giving a week of purchase or store ID, some other any variable. If I am giving and if I am running again, I will get the same, because my entire data set which have 1070 observation with 18 variables. So all these variables have 1070 observation, right? That's why this is for the easiness. We have given the first column name, and the third option, this you have to manually give, or else your output will be stored in a list format. But what format we need? We need a integer format. So for that, I am giving explicitly list equal to false. So at last I am getting number of training data. If you know the number of training data, you can easily identify the remaining numbers, right, using negation. So how I am going to create training data? I have created a new object called training data. In this, orange is my data set name. Okay, orange is my data set name. Training number, it is 857, comma all the columns. So comma all the columns. If I run this, my training data have 857 observation of 18 variables, and this remaining has to be for test data. I am using a negation symbol. So remaining 213 observation come for test data. So now we have divided our data into training set and test set. This we will come later. First I want to check whether any NA is available in our training data. For that we have a function called NA, any NA. We have already saw is.NA. Is.NA is different. Any NA is, if you are giving a particular data frame, if there is any not available data is there in your data frame, it will show you a single result, that is true or false. But is.NA, what it will give for every element, it will check. We have 1070 observation into 18 variables. For that, there is only one NA available. Then you think if you apply is.NA, it is difficult to check, right? For that, we have a separate function called any NA. Yes, we have a NA variable here. Now for pre-processing, that is the first step, you have to remove the missing variable part. How we can remove the missing variable part? Using the pre-process function. It is an inbuilt function available in the Carrot package. So first thing, we have to create a model. For that model, I am calling this pre-process function, and I am passing the training data as the input. The training data as the input, and method equal to knn impute. I am using a method called knearest neighbor for imputing the missing values. Now if I execute this and I am running this model, now we have created from 831 samples and 18 variables. Okay, we have total 857. In that 831 samples and 18 variables, it was created. The pre-processing happened for 16 variables, the value has been centered, and two variables, two values, it was ignored. Five, based on nearest neighbor, the value was imputed, and 16 variables, the value, it is scaled. Okay, so this scaled, centered, that only I have mentioned in the slide. So this range is a one pre-process function where it will give you, it will convert your data into a particular range. If between 0 to 1, it will convert. If you want to center your data, you have to add all the data and you have to subtract by mean. And scaling is dividing by standard deviation. PCA is a one of the most frequently used method for feature extraction, replacing with the principal components. ICA is a independent component. Principal component analysis and independent component analysis is a very it's a separate topic that we are not concentrating in this session. It's a pre-processing function. Now we have completed this part. This KNN impute, we know KNN as a classification algorithm, right? But here we are using KNN for imputing in the sense, instead of NA, I want to change to some other value. How KNN will be useful here? KNN, how it will work? I'll just give brief introduction to this KNN. How it will work is, if your K is 5, that is number of neighbors I am giving it as a 5, I will calculate the distance, Euclidean distance between the data points, and I will rank the distance. So who are all my closest neighbor? Based on who are all my closest neighbor and what is their value, based on that I will check. If out of 5, 3 members are telling 0 and 2 members are telling 1. So there are 2 values in my column, and one is 0, another is 1. 3 people are telling 0 and 2 people are telling 1. Then what I will do, for missing data I will mark it as 0, because there are 3 major members are telling that this value is 0. So I will convert, I will just replace my missing data with a 0. Okay, so KNN will try to impute the missing data. That's how it will work. So this theoretical part I have omitted, and directly we'll think that KNN algorithm is used to impute the missing data. Now I want to predict this pre-processing model with the training data. Okay, for that I am using a library called RAN. If you have not installed a RAN, it will show you error. So download this RAN packet also, either using this package or install that package. Now I am executing and I got my code executed. Now I am checking the training data. Here I have checked, right? I got true. Now I have pre-processed and I have imputed the value using KNN. Now if I check any NA, it will show me the false. There is no NA now. Now your data is pre-processed and your missing value is rectified. Now another topic is called one-hot encoding. One-hot encoding is nothing but, if you have a categorical variable, for example red, green, blue, I have one column which is having red, green, blue, but I want to perform mathematical operation on that column. How I will do? I need to convert this categorical value into the numerical form. How I will change is, for red I will allocate a number. As it is a computer, we will add a binary based number. If it is a red, it is 000. If it is a green, 010. If it is a blue, it is 100. For that we will add extra columns for that categorical value to convert into a number format for our operation. So it's creating dummy variables. Okay, so for that I am using this dummies model. It's a given for name, and I am using this function called dummy variables. For this dummy variable I need to pass a formula. So what formula I am passing? This purchase. Before that I will show you the head part. Head of orange. Yes, if you see, there are 18 variables options are there. Here I am taking this purchase column and I am passing data as a training data. I am passing training data and I am creating a dummy variable. For that I am using this predict function for this dummy model with a new training data. If I run the code, you will come to know how it has changed. Okay. If you see here structure of training data, if you see structure of orange, we have removed this purchase part. Okay, the purchase part has been removed and we have added a dummy variable for store number 7. So store number 7, before that it was yes or no categorical variable. For that what we have added, for yes it is a another variable 0 and 1 we have changed. So because of that we have again 18 variables. We have removed that purchase and we are taking this store as a categorical value. Based on that it has created a new data. You see this structure part of orange, you will get some more information. Structure of orange. If you see this part here, if you see store, it is a character. No, 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 yes, 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 like that it was there. The prediction model is going to predict the purchase. Purchase is our class variable. So I am removing it from training data. Okay. Purchase, I am going to removing it from the training data. And what I have added? I have added this dummy model. This will create a new variable for store 7, because other than that there is no other option you cannot do. Okay, so this is the only way you can apply here. For that I have used one hot encoding. So one hot encoding is nothing but it will create a new variable for converting the categorical into a binary form for doing some mathematical operation. That's all from this caret part, and next we will go for the next section of caret. We will go with the machine learning part. So for that you install this library, that is applied predictive modeling. Already caret has been installed and I have loaded all this, and you install this package also. So ROC, I think now ROC is not required. I have given you a part of code only here. So now I am using the iris data. Iris also a data set available in this part itself. Now I am preparing the data set. If you see about iris data, I will clear all this environment now. This also I will clear, then only we will understand. So prepare the data set. When I have give the summary, it is showing me 5 different variables: sepal length, sepal width, petal width, petal length, petal width, and at last different species. Now you see how the feature is related to each other using a feature plot. I am executing this code. If you know, if you see here, up to now it was in some other part here. Either it may be in package or if you are in file, it may be there. But if you plot, if you execute this code, automatically this will be changed to plot. And this plot is nothing but for each column is compared with other columns which is related to the species. So we have five columns. These four columns, the fifth column is based on the values of these four columns. So I want to relate how these four columns are related to each other. So I have used this chart. Now similar to that, I am creating a index that is splitting into training and test data. So I have created a data partition, probability 8, list equal to false, and only one time it has to execute, so times equal to 1. Now like with the positive and negation index, I have created this test data and training data. So training data is of 120, test data is of 30. If you want to see from here in coding, you have to see from here. Now this is the cross validation part. Cross validation is nothing but when you are dividing your data set into training set and test set, sometimes your data underfit. This cross validation will give you an option to create different subsets of data. The methods are available, so k-fold cross validation, then repeated cross validation, like that there are multiple methods are there. So here I am giving you the name here. After this session, you please go through this cross validation part. You can learn easily. I am giving the number is 10, so 10 times 10 numbers I am dividing, and I am repeating for 5 different types. Yes, I think comment I got, could not find error function feature plot. I think you have to add ggplot. If you have ggplot, by caret itself, I think ggplot will be added. Whether anyone is having issue with this feature plot? So it is used to understand between the features. I am plotting it. Do not find the error function feature plot. Okay, we will see if it. So this is the major point in online hands-on session. We can't able to help you that much. Okay, let's see. At last, I have very limited time now, so I want to complete ggplot. So I will move on to this next one. So this cross validation is very important to have an optimized model. And the first one is I am using decision tree. Here I want to show you how much easy the task is, the applying classification in R using caret package. I am just calling the train function. First part is the class variable. Our end agenda is to predict the species. Okay, in iris data we have four columns. Based on this four column data, we want to predict the fifth column. Thus this class variable should be given as the first input and data equal to our training data. Now we are going to train, right? So we are going to give the training data as this variable name. This is a variable name. If you have a training data as a name, here you have to pass training data. And method equal to R part. R part is for decision tree. For implementing decision tree, we will use the method R part. And this is control parameter. This control parameter, it will take input from this cross validation. Based on this cross validation, it will take this input. Based on that, it will train the data. The training data will get the control information from here. How many times you want to divide your data? How much time it has to repeat? Like that, information will be passed here, and I want to pre-process using center and scale. We have already saw, right? PCA, center, scale, ICA. I am passing this as a pre-processing function. Based on this, we have created a model using this part. If I am running this code, first this one I will run. Sorry, I think I have not executed this part. That's why it is showing error, object fit control not found. So from that I identified that this part is not executed. Now we have our training is completed and we are storing it in an object, right? I am printing that object. We will see what is there in the object. So from this part, we are using this cart and 120 samples, 4 predictors, 3 classes, and pre-processing centered 4, scale 4, 4 values, 4 values has been centered, 4 values been scaled, and we used tenfold cross validation repeated 5 times. Based on this input, it is showing us all the information. Summary of sample size, we have 150, right? In that 150, 120 is the training data. From that 108 has been taken for a sample, and based on that it has computed accuracy and kappa. This evaluation metric itself is another large topic that we don't want to go here. I want to convey how much easy is to implement machine learning in R. Now I go on to predict. My training is completed. I want to test whether my model is working. I have used a prediction function, predict function to predict. I am passing 2 input. First one is my machine learning model DT, decision tree dot fit, and the next one is test. My prediction is executed and I want to plot the confusion matrix for the part. Now this is the confusion matrix. If you see, there are 30 test data, 120 training data and 30 test data. If you see here, 30 out of 30, the original setosa is predicted as setosa is 10 out of 10 it predicted exactly, and versicolor is predicted as versicolor is 8, and virginica is predicted as versicolor is 2, virginica is predicted as virginica is 10. Okay, if you match all this value, you will get 30, and our accuracy for the model is 93%, that is 0.933, and these are the common metrics they will use: sensitivity, specificity, positive predictive value, negative predictive value, detection rate, detection accuracy. All the evaluation metrics will be provided using this confusion matrix itself. Now decision tree, this much only I have used. For KNN, what you have to use? You just copy paste everything, method equal to KNN, that's all. If you run the model, I will just run all this code together. Now my model is training and my model executed, and the accuracy of my model is 96.67%. It is better than decision tree. Now I want to change to random forest. What I have to do? Method equal to RF. You just need to know what is the method available. I am just running this code. My model is training, and at last I got result. My accuracy is 100% for random forest. All 10 out of 10 was predicted exactly. Okay. This is how we can use Carrot by using different data type. So you change your data type. If you know what are the machine learning model you are going to use, first do the pre-processing, then train the model, then give the control information like cross-validation and test the model, then show the confusion matrix. If confusion matrix is not sufficient, and you want to print your data in a more visually appealing manner, that is where ggplot comes into picture. Ggplot I will complete in 2 or 3 minutes. It's very easy. I have given you very simple code. First you install this ggplot package. You just delete this command part and execute it. Due to time constraint, I am not installing. I will directly move on to this library. I have installed, and here I am using a data set called MPG. MPG is a mileage data set. It will analyze car and it will provide you the mileage. And first plot. For ggplot, I will show you in one slide. That is the major information I need to convey for ggplot. So pre-processing we saw. Ggplot is for producing the statistical graphical way of showing your result. So every ggplot have three components. These three components you need to know. The first one is actually the data. The second one is the aesthetic. We will mark it as AES. In R, we will tell us AES, that is aesthetics mapping between the data and its properties. And at last, it is the geometric function. We will need to describe how to render the each observation. So GEOM, it was mentioned as a geometrical function. And whenever you are using ggplot, you will use a plus symbol which is added at the end of each layer to differentiate between the each layer will be easily identified by using this plus symbol. Now I will show you the graph. As I have told you, three components, right? First component is my data, which is MPG. Next component is my AES, that is aesthetics. For aesthetics, two mandatory arguments are there. First one is x and y, x-axis and y-axis, axis and y-axis for a graph. For x-axis, I am marking a displacement in this car, in this data set. Displacement data I am marking it as x-axis, and y-axis as a mileage available in the highway. I am mapping the relationship between the displacement is nothing but the engine size with the mileage I am mapping. And plus symbol was introduced to add the layer. And how I am introducing the geometric function using the GEOM point. If you see, yes. Sorry, I think I have executed. First I will, this one I will go. This is how my data point has been plotted. All these values are GEOM point. Now I want to show the difference with the class. There are different class available. If you see here, class, this compact, then SUV, then like that, different classes are available. I am differentiating with different colors. Okay, two-seater has been given in one color, compact, mid-size, minivan, pickup, subcompact, SUV. All these different class variables, I am plotting it using different colors. By default, what is the variable name will be taken as the x-axis name. Here, the highway mileage is given as a y-axis name. Similarly, we can identify this compact mid-size SUV have better mileage in the highway. Like that, you can infer from the plot. Plot is used to provide a meaningful information. And this next one is faceting. This faceting is a creating table of graphics by splitting the data into subsets and displaying the same graph for each subset. If you want to identify the impact of any column in each available variable, example, if you want to show, you can use this faceting concept. I will show with the plot. Here I am passing display and highway as an input, point as a geometric function, and I am using facet trap as a class. So for each class, it will plot the data point. Here we have how many classes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 classes. So the result we will get is 7 different graphs in a single plot. Okay, 7 different graphs you got in a single plot. For 2-seater, the x-axis is displacement, that is engine size, and y-axis is a highway. Similar to that, for all the 7 classes, we have created 7 different plots. The next one is, along with the point, I am adding one more layer using smooth function. Smooth function is to identify the relationship between this density, like how much dense this point, to find the relationship, that smoothing line in between the data, where the points get accumulated more. Now, the most common issue while we will face is overplotting. If there is a more similar value, we will get this overplotting issue. To avoid overplotting, there are 3 different ways available. We will add a little noise to each data and we will plot. If you see here, instead of plotting in the same line, we are plotting by adding little bit noise and by using box plot. Now, I will take some 2 more minutes, that's all. So now I am introducing with the box plot, similarly with the violin plot. So when the data is more related and you want to see the ranges, you can use this 3 different bar plots, box plot, violin plot and jitter. And the next one is bar plot. Bar is nothing but, hope you know this, a bar chart, where I am keeping manufacturer as a x-axis and count as a y-axis. And at last, if you want to change all this axis name manually, you have to use this labs. So instead of that, I am giving additional information. First, the x-axis, instead of DASPL, I am placing displacement, engine displacement. Here, instead of highway, I am keeping highway miles per gallon. Here, number of cylinders, 4, 5, 6, 8. And the title, subtitle. Similar to that, you can add all this information and you can go through it. There are multiple options also available, like heat map, confusion, like you can directly map confusion matrix with heat map. Similar to that, you can plot. That's all. I think carrot we have completed. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.